That's Vorthry. He's attended by sin eaters. But how does he keep them from attacking?
Mercy!
By the 12! Kaishia, what happened to you?
Who are these impudent louts? I do not recall requesting their presence.
What is the meaning of this? Why is this poor man bleeding to death on your floor?
Why? You ask me why? Because criminals must be punished. And this man is guilty of fraud. He came to us, claiming to be a man of business. Yet his subsequent conduct has shown him to be anything but. City built on love for one's fellow man. Those who have naught to give and live only to take are a blight upon our society. To atone for this crime, I ordered that he fling himself from the balcony. And he had the temerity to weep. Please, my lord! Anything but that! What then is a man of mercy to do? But offer the sinner another way to show his contrition.
Another way? Meaning what exactly?
Sin eaters are part of Yulmor society. But they must be fed with ether. Living ether. So, I demanded an offering of flesh, carved by his own hand, from his own hide. And still, he could not do as I asked. A wholly unsatisfactory performance.
'Tis true that Kaishia won his place here by fraud, but his actions were driven only by a desire to share in your paradise. That you would cast him out, I could almost accept, but to humiliate him thus, to demand his very life? Is this truly the way of Yulmore?
Pause to consider what it takes to maintain such a paradise in this barren, broken world of ours. The guarantee of safety and stability. The knowledge that if one only abides by the rules, one has naught to fear.
I alone can offer these things, for I alone can command the Sin Eaters.
And thus am I alone the voice of justice, and any who oppose me, villains to be punished. Then you shall paint a picture for me of Yulmore. If I find your art pleasing, then I may excuse this display of insolence. Permission to tend to that criminal wound. I told you to paint me a picture.
What you need is a mirror, not a painting. It will capture the horror I see before me far better than I could.
Thank you. Arang. From this parched earth, the nation of Nabath, Arang once rose. When I journeyed here, long ago, I spoke with a sun-weathered elder. He told me Arang meant majestic land in the language of his people. And so it might still be, were it not for the Light's unrelenting onslaught.
Thank you. Master Gengen, this is the friend of the Exarch I was telling you about.
Very good, very good. Though friend or no, all are welcome in Mordsook.
Sook is Mordish for city. As things stand, this Sook boasts the largest and busiest marketplace in all Armorang. You'll find ore from the mines here, of course, but all manner of other things too, many of them rare. As I told you before, not many visit Armorang by choice, but Mordsook's a different story. Merchants come from realms around to purchase the relics the Mord dig up.
Aye, that they do, for Mord do not dismiss the spoils of the earth. We clean them and polish them and reveal to the world their true value. That is why they come here, come from far away, come with much money. And so our Sook is always busy, busy, busy. No such thing as a thing no one needs.
You say that every time, Master Gengen. Some sort of family motto, wasn't it? Or perhaps a Mord philosophy, for which we should all be very grateful. Would that everyone was so willing to take in refugees, regardless of race or creed. Now then, if you intend to spend any time here, you'll want to gain the trust of the locals. And there's a little custom all newcomers are expected to observe.
The cracking of the coin purse. You buy one thing from the market. Price can be low or high, just as long as you buy.
As the good Mord says. In fact, the Exarch sent a little something to cover this very expense. A Verbert gold piece, no less. The first I've held in years.
Gold? Hail Verbert Gold!
Here, newcomer, crack your coin purse with me.
Oh no, you want my goods, newcomer. I have jars and pots, all smooth and shiny.
Over here!
Come and look!
You buy, you buy.
Enough of that! Calm, I say! This one must still journey through the barrens. Nothing bulky, nothing heavy, no pots. Nothing better for the road than a full belly. Spend that piece at Ronron's place, yes? Eat for three before you leave.
Thank you. Just a lesser sin eater. Nothing to write home about. I knew you'd turn up sooner or later, but I had been hoping for sooner. How are you? We've fought them to a standstill then. The Exarch did say that the Empire seemed to have drawn back when he last looked in on the source. But without knowing for sure how fast time was passing there, I couldn't help worrying that a lot might have happened since then. I'm heartily relieved to hear that it hasn't, just as Alphano must have been. As you can imagine, both he and Arianger were desperate to hear the news from home when I arrived. I haven't actually seen Thancred and Yshtola yet, but they will have heard all the latest developments from the Exarch by now, or should have at least. When I think of how frantic Tataru and the others must be, I want nothing more than to rush back and reassure them. But we still haven't found a way to reverse the summoning. And even if we had, we couldn't just ignore Urielje's vision. He may use 10 words where one would suffice, and they may often obscure as much as they reveal. But on this matter, he was as clear as day. I do not doubt for one moment that he saw what he claims. Nor how difficult it must have been to speak about them. The 8th Umbral Calamity and your death aren't exactly topics for idle conversation. As much as I might want to go home, I don't want to go home to that. We can't allow the rejoining to happen. Which means we have to save the first from the Sin Eaters. That great wall of white is a remnant of the Flood. 100 years ago, the balance in the First tipped decisively in favor of light. From that moment, it rose and swelled with each passing day, and then without warning, it burst forth like water from a broken dam. A colossal wave of pure light, drowning everything in its wake. Only Norvrant was spared. For the most part, living things are composed of ether of various different aspects. But when exposed to such a flood, their etheric harmony is shattered, and their natural form breaks down. Then they either perish, or are warped into mindless abominations. Yes, that's how the Sin Eaters came to be. They were once living creatures, or people, that were caught in the path of the Flood. Once the change is wrought, there is no going back. In that instant, they are gripped by an insatiable appetite for ether, and will happily gorge themselves on any living thing within reach. But even that is not the worst of it. The stronger Sin Eaters can plant light in us, like seeds in soil, corrupting our ether, and triggering the birth of new monstrosities. They are creatures of base instinct, that exist only to feed and to multiply. They feel no pity. Know no remorse and are utterly deaf to reason. Which is why they must be destroyed. Every last one of them. The infirmary is full of the Sin Eaters' victims, left here to spend their final hours waiting for the change to overtake them.
Thank you. Thank you.
Look, over there, where the wall is broken. Do you see what lies? That's what the land became after the light flooded in. An empty, white nothing. Life cannot exist in such conditions. The primordial light would wreak havoc on the body's That nectarine you bought. It's Halric's favorite fruit. Most of the patients, Halric included, survived the attack, but their fate was sealed all the same. The monster's corruption has entered their bodies. The twisted state of the world itself just makes matters worse. Under normal circumstances, a person's ether naturally tends to equilibrium. But for these poor souls, the opposite. Sooner or later, every single one of them will turn. Tesleen and the patients, they all know this. They know what has to be done before the change goes too far. Before the eater within takes over. The preferred method is mixing poison into their favorite food. In my time here, I feel just as helpless as before. No matter how hard I fight, it's never enough. But it's a war I mean to wage, nonetheless. Speaking of wars, do you remember how I made you promise not to leave me, and then promptly collapsed? Well, let's just say I had a few choice words for the Exarch concerning the timing of his summons. But even if the fault lay with someone else, I couldn't shake the feeling that I'd abandon you on the battle. So I swore that I'd make up for my absence there by making a difference here. And that's what keeps me moving forward, even when things seem hopeless. On which note, it's time we headed back. The longer we keep Tesleen waiting, the harder this will be for her.
Speak up if you'd like another helping. I made a little bit more than usual today.
You've added something special to the broth, if I'm not mistaken.
Aye, well, it's not often we have visitors from the Crystarium, so I may have thrown in a few extra bits and bobs. So rarely have guests. In a place like this, you learn to take what moments of happiness you can get. I remember when I first came here with my mother. She was showing the early signs. I knew there was no way to save her. But I just couldn't face what needed to be done. That's the way of it for most people. Why they travel for moms to stay here. Beaten, broken souls come to wait out the inevitable. To receive the mercy of a painless death. When my mother finally left this world, I was mad with grief, but also thankful that her passing was a peaceful one. It's never easy ending a life you've cared for, even when you believe they go on to a better place. I often find myself wishing the Warrior of Darkness would come and do that part for me.
The Warrior of Darkness?
You've never heard the tale? I'm not sure where it began, but every child in Norvrand could tell you a version of it. Warrior of Darkness, servant of death, take care of our souls at our dying breath. Let sinners and eaters of sin go with thee, that all may return to the sunless sea. Well, that's the version I was taught anyway. It's just an old bedtime story. He certainly never deigned to visit us here.
Which is a good thing, surely. He sounds rather ominous.
Do you think so? I always liked the idea that he treated every soul the same, even the sin eaters.
They're coming.
Desleen! Have you seen Halric? I swear, I only took my eyes off him for a moment.
Of him? No luck then. But he surely can't have gone far. We should keep looking. The Sin Eaters are out in force, and if we don't find him soon, you can be sure they will. you see the size of that thing? It must be one of the nasty ones. Wherever it's going, it can only mean trouble.
We all deserve happiness, wherever we can find it. The time left to you is precious. No one should die in vain. Mother, Mother, I...
Thank you. So you return. Have you gained a better understanding of the crisis now faced by the First?
Better is not the word I would use. Some lands may have been spared the flood, but the survivors live only to suffer. There seems no end to the horrors inflicted.
Indeed. Those abominations are a calamity in their own right. And I can well imagine how hopeless the task of eradicating them must seem to you. But after countless battles and untold sacrifice, we have identified a potential weakness. Sin Eaters are drawn to serve the strongest of their kind, a class of creature we call Light Wardens. And from what we have been able to ascertain, only a handful of these entities exist. Just as an ant colony will perish in the absence of its queen, we believe that the death of a Light Warden will cause the lesser creatures within its sphere of influence to disperse.
I have a feeling Yulmor might have something to say about any concerted action we take against these monsters. Vorthra's command over the Sin Eaters is integral to Yulmoran society. In seeming to guarantee his people's safety, it guarantees their obedience. He will not take kindly to us depriving him of such useful allies.
Agreed. Thus we will need to occupy or otherwise divert his forces whilst we proceed with the business of eliminating the Wardens. Until we have done so, all other considerations must be set aside if we are to forestall the eighth Umbral Calamity. Your uncertainty is understandable given the circumstances. Perhaps a more detailed explanation is in order. In the ancient past, a single star was divided into 14 worlds. This is the source, your home. These others are the 13 shards, in whose number we find the first. Though physically separate, they retain a connection to each other, and with the source especially. Now, let us assume that a given element in one of the shards attains abnormal ascendancy. Just as water will flow from the highest point to the lowest, the excess energy will begin trickling. And such an influx of ether will of course exert a palpable influence. If the element in question were fire, then drought and wildfires might ensue. If it were ice, one might expect the weather to turn bitterly cold. As ether continues to pour in, such phenomena will become more and more extreme, until eventually, a single, untimely event triggers a disaster which cracks the barrier dividing the two worlds. What was once a trickle now becomes a deluge, sweeping the shard along to be rejoined with the source. At the same time, the element which held sway in the shard is unleashed in full, its energies amplifying the original disaster to truly catastrophic proportions. An earthquake thus magnified might strike with enough force to shatter continents. A tidal wave might swell to a size capable of drowning entire nations. These devastating events are what we refer to as Umbral Calamities. 7 times has a calamity befallen the source. 7 times has a shard been absorbed. Ah! The light-drowned realm of the First stands perilously close to meeting the conditions for a rejoining. It is the Sin Eaters who are to blame for the Light's continued dominance. In addition to attracting their lesser kin, the Light Wardens I mentioned earlier radiate ether, saturating every corner of their territory with light. Even here in the flood-spared region of Novrat, their influence is strong enough to banish night from the sky. Thus, if we are to restore balance to the First and head off a potential calamity, it is imperative that we put each and every Light Warden to the sword.
We've been doing our best to take the fight to the enemy ever since we first heard the Exarch's explanation.
Though we have yet to claim any meaningful victories, if truth be told. Apart from being confoundingly elusive, the Light Wardens possess a troublesome quality which compelled us to delay our plans until such time as you arrived.
Forgive the interruption, my lord, but Hallminster Switch is requesting reinforcements. They say the Sin Eaters are attacking in force and the village could soon be overrun.
Alert the guard. We should be prepared in case the fighting reaches the Crystarium. You have command of our forces in the field, Captain, but hold off on entering the town until I arrive. That goes for Alphino and Alize as well.
My lord.
Pray, lend us your strength. Such a fight will provide you with far greater insight than any explanation I could offer.